So could we please stand if you can?
Thank you. O Lord God, you are the creator and the one who still is about the work of creating. Your Spirit's palette is bringing form and color to the world around us, and the beauty we see brings joy to our lives. As we gather in this time of worship, we look to you and your ongoing work in our lives. Where life appears to have fallen apart, bring new form and structure. Where life appears void and dark, bring to us the beauty of your spectrum. Today is a day of new beginnings and new possibilities. Make us aware of who you are and where you will be taking us. We offer these words of prayer in the name of your redemptive gift, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Well, folks, we are the body of Christ here in this place, and it is good to be together. We welcome you, and we're so glad that the body of Christ is here in this place today. But there's something we need to do, and it's a little tricky. But we need to kind of greet each other in the spirit of Christian love and exactly. So if you're turning your
thank you. there, I got so tickled. I look at Mike's keyboard that is on two benches. I love the creativity. So if you've got a few places in your row, I hear you still have a few places up in the balcony, I see a couple hands going up and stuff. We would let folks know out there to come on in. Maybe they snuck in upstairs during that closing song. Thanks for scooting. At this time, I want to invite Shane and Sherry Brooks to join me up front, along with Noah and his new brother. I tell you, when we thought we were getting back here today, this was the day that we had originally scheduled for the baby dedication, and they called me and said, do you think we go ahead and do it in light of everything? And I said, absolutely. I think it's exactly what the church needs right now. So, you know, as all of you know, our mission as a church is to put love first in all things. Our mission is to help families and individuals live this love first life. And one of the things that I love about baby dedications is it reminds us that place that maybe we glimpse God's capacity to love us first is in the love the parents have for a child. When that gift comes into life, we don't have any sense that that child's going to love us back. And yet that's not our decision. That's not how we even act or react. There's just a part of us that has to love this gift that has shown up. And I think in many ways, that's the way God views us. God isn't waiting for us to love God or love others. God doesn't wait for anything to happen. God is the one who acted first on our behalf. As we take the time today to dedicate this gift to the world, I want to remind you about how this isn't something that we just designed a few years ago. It's something that we find in Scripture, not just in the Christian Scripture, but also within the Old Testament. The need to dedicate a child, and actually, I don't think it was the last dedication I did. I think it may have been a couple of dedications ago. One of our young people came up to me and said, well, even Simba was dedicated in the movie. You know, there is something important about giving thanks for the gift of a child. And so I want to ask the two of you, as you received this gift from the hand of a loving Creator, do you accept with humility and hope all the responsibility which is yours to love and nurture him and to lead him to faith, not only through your words, but through your actions? If so, please say we do. And I also want to ask you, will you ask for the power of God's Spirit? Will you ask for the support of family? Will you seek the encouragement of your community of faith, knowing that parenting is not always the easiest task, but great strength is found in the community around us. If so, please say no. And Noah? Yes. And Cypress Creek Christian Church. nurture this child, wherever it might be, to be that model of God's first love, so that as he grows up, he understands that he is a precious gift. And then over time, he can not only celebrate that, but he can help others come to that realization. If you're willing to do that, please say, "We will."
We will.
I ask you now, what name have you given this child?
Brady Lowers.
We name you this day, Brady Lyle, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. That is a marvelous name, and we are thankful for the gift that you are. And that name will be mentioned many times in years to come. And that smile that you had, I'm sure will be the smile seen upon your parents' face as well. I'm going to see if you'll come to me. Okay, I want you to take a peek at these people. What do you think of them? They're a pretty attractive bunch, aren't they? Well, among this group of people you have all around you, these are people that have said that they will love you, that they will encourage you, that they will be a part of your life. And they have committed themselves to helping you, your parents, your brother, to teach you all kinds of marvelous things. For in Jesus, God came into the world for you. You don't know much about this, but guess what? We'll continue to help teach you that, won't we, Noah? And this day, we celebrate that marvelous role. I'm going to invite you to join me in a word of prayer. God, we give you thanks for all the marvelous gifts that you offer us, for every life that comes into this world. May we continue to not only celebrate the preciousness of every gift, but may we as a community of faith help share that news with others. For Brady this day, we just celebrate his presence in the life of this community. And may the love that has been felt in this space today be a love that he continues to know every day of his life. We ask all of this in the name of your most precious gift, Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Remembrance and celebrate her life.
St. Dunstan's is just one of the churches that has been so gracious to us at this time. Joel and our handbell choir is not here this morning because they're at Plymouth United Church of Christ, which is where the handbells have been practicing, so that they can share the gift of handbell music with their worship service this morning. It's just a way of saying thank you. So some good stuff, some good sharing that is going on. Next Sunday, we are going to stick with just one service at 10:30 back here. It is World Communion Sunday, a time when the church comes together in a very special way, and so I celebrate that. And just one other thing I want to lift up, and I don't know where Mariah is. Mariah, raise your hand. She's up there in the balcony. This past week, in the midst of everything, she celebrated her one-year anniversary with us. And among the many gifts that are on staff here, she was one of them, and we are thankful for that. We invite now the choir to offer their gift. verse from Philippians, assuming my iPad turns on. First chapter, verse 6, for these words. I'm sure about this. The one who started a good work in you will stay with you to complete the job by the day of Christ Jesus. I'm sure about this. The one who started a good work in you will stay with you to complete the job by the day of Christ Jesus. Let us pray. Now, pop this big ego, set aside our pride, that you might reside, O Lord, in all that is said and done. In the name of the living Word, we pray. Amen. This past week, I made 3 trips down to visit folks at the medical center. Every time, driving down 45, traffic. The second of the 3 trips, I was on my way down to going 45 on 45. And in my rearview mirror, I noticed a truck fast approaching, weaving in and out of traffic. Right before it reached me, it went all the way to the right-hand lane. I was hoping he was going to exit off at that point, but no, he stayed there only for a second before coming across all the lanes of traffic, nearly hitting the car next to me, having to swerve, nearly hitting me. As it came past me, I noticed that it was a truck for a construction company. As it came back again, it paused in the lane that I was in, just ahead of me, and that's when I saw on its bumper the words, "Safety is always number one." I thought it should have had an addition, "Safety is always number one, dot, 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 for everyone else." It's as if the driver was saying, "Thank goodness it is someone else's responsibility to make everything safe." We as human beings, I think, are wired in such a way that we are quick to toss responsibility onto someone else. There have been times, even in Christian history, where people of faith have ignored the suffering of other human beings, suggesting, well, you know, it's not my responsibility. I mean, if God wants to do something about it, God will take care of it. Of course, the last few weeks, we have seen just the opposite. We have witnessed people not just sitting around waiting for God to do whatever it was that God wanted to do, but people who were listening for the call of God, and people who were choosing to join God in the good work, the good work that the Apostle Paul talks about. What breaks my heart are the folks who have and continue to fall through the cracks. And there are many. I had a conversation a little over a week ago with Greg Hahn. Greg is on, he's a Presbyterian minister, but he is on staff with the Interfaith Ministries of Greater Houston. It is the 5th largest provider of Meals on Wheels in the United States. And so they are out in the community. And he said the response has been just incredible. Neighbors helping neighbors. But then he added, there are small communities, small neighborhoods in Houston that nobody knows about, where families have been flooded out and no group has come to help them. And they don't even know how to get on the grid to get help. And there is a growing sense of hopelessness and despair among these people. I believe that we probably all have had moments like that in our own lives, where we look to the future only to see darkness. Our circumstance is more than just bleak. And in our weaker moments, we say to ourselves, is this it? Is this all there is? Is this where my story ends? Later in that first chapter of Philippians, Paul says to the church there, you are having the same struggles that you saw me facing, that I am, he says, still facing. The struggles of persecution, arrest, beatings, all kinds of things that Paul was facing. And here he's suggesting that not only is Paul and Timothy and other church leaders, but the people in Philippi, they too are experiencing great pain and suffering. And you've got to think that there were moments when these people thought to themselves, this must be it. It being either death or a complete loss of hope. That idea is often found in the Psalms, those wonderful poetic prayers. And in Psalm 69, it begins this way, save me, God, because the waters have reached my neck. I have sunk into deep mud. I have entered the deep water. The flood has swept me up. I'm tired of crying. My throat is hoarse. I'm exhausted in my waiting for God. That is the cry of so many people. Whether it is literally the storms like those that we have experienced the past month, or illness, or a broken relationship, or the sudden loss of a job, or the death of a loved one. When a person finds him or herself thrust to the edge of the abyss, where tomorrow does not even appear possible, let alone imagine. But to that, Paul writes that one verse that I shared at the beginning. I am sure about this. It can be translated, I am convinced about this, that the one who started a good work in you will stay with you to complete the job. The story that God is writing in us and through us is not a story that will ultimately end in the darkness of the abyss, even though we may have convinced ourselves that's the case. When Paul wrote, God will stay with us to complete the job, the word complete, at least the original Greek word that we translate as complete, could also be translated as accomplished or perfected, or as one pastor suggested, this phrase could be translated that God will ultimately bring it to the best ending imaginable. Can you imagine some of those early Christians? Those people that had been persecuted? Those people that found the world underneath them crumbling, it appeared at times, to hear these words from the Apostle Paul that suggests that the good thing that God has been doing is something that is still happening in their midst. And even though it may appear one way, it may appear dark, they may feel as if they've gotten to the edge of that abyss, that they may not be able to perceive will be better than they ever could have imagined. One of the best parts of my ministry is the joy, the great joy that I have doing weddings for people that have come out of great brokenness and pain. Jim and Lynn had both gone through a very ugly, they both got their ugly divorces. Very painful. And that was hard to watch.
Because they both previously have been people of great light and joy, and yet throughout that time we just saw two individuals that looked so broken. And you just ached for them. But about 2 years after the divorce, these two people who had known each other in the church found each other. And it wasn't long before they made an appointment, came into my office and said, "Help us plan a wedding. Help us plan a wedding that, yes, celebrates God's love, but more importantly," they said, "we want the service to celebrate God's faithfulness. A faithfulness that is there even when you cannot perceive it." And so it was their wedding, a worship service. We sang hymns and songs, and almost all of them were about God's faithfulness, even amidst the trouble. Those voices are found throughout the scriptures, found in so many places. People who maybe are not even able to perceive what God is doing, but they trust. They believe that God has not walked away. I started the sermon talking about responsibility. Well, this idea of God starting a good work among us and God being faithful to completing that good work, bringing it to some full completion. Well, it needs on occasion, probably more than on just occasion, an individual to announce that truth. The people in Philippi needed someone like the Apostle Paul, who would come and announce to them that the good work God started among you, God will hang with you, and God will see it completed, accomplished. God will, in the end, make it something more beautiful than you ever could have imagined. When someone believes that they are typing the final line of their life and it is not a good ending, when somebody is feeling so hopeless that that hopelessness has obscured any possibility of a future, when someone has tossed in the towel and said, "I am done," we have a responsibility to the call of God. Yet too often people are a bit cautious. It's not my place. It's not my responsibility. If God wants to take better care of it, God will do so. Well, I believe that God is saying to us, "Yes, I want to take care of it, and I am asking you to help me do that." Whether it is after a divorce, a flood, a death, or even the facing of one's own mortality, God calls us as people of faith to provide a witness to the good work that God has done and the good work that God continues to do. A work that will ultimately be complete, accomplished, perfected in something that is probably more beautiful than any of us could ever imagine. When I was serving the church in Kansas City, I'd only been there maybe 4 years, when a couple, who's just a little older than I was, joined the church. They had a daughter who was 9 years old. Her name is Samantha. And Samantha had been dealing with some health issues, but they couldn't quite figure it out. Well, shortly after they joined the church, Samantha was diagnosed with cancer. The family went through so many ups and downs, so many times in the hospital and back out, so much pain and struggle. But when Samantha was 11, they said, "There's nothing more we can do." And Samantha came home under hospice care. A couple of agencies stepped in and wanted to offer her a wish, anything she might like. And a couple of nice gestures were made. But then Samantha saw what she wanted. She had been watching TV and she saw a commercial. Actually, it was an infomercial. And she knew exactly what she wanted. That infomercial was for a psychic. And she wanted to see if they would fly the psychic in to do a personal psychic reading. She wanted it desperately. Her parents turned to me and said, "What do we do with this? She wants it so badly." Not being in their shoes, I did not have an easy answer to that. They said, "We think we're going to ask this foundation to do that, but will you be there? Maybe just off to the side, or maybe in another room, will you be there the day the psychic comes?" I said, "Sure." So the day came, and the psychic came and sat down with Samantha. For about 30 minutes, they chit-chatted. There was quite a bit of laughter. And then the psychic kind of went into her psychic ways and said a few things. And then she said to Samantha, "Samantha, your story doesn't end with your death. There are still beautiful and amazing chapters to be written. Beautiful and amazing chapters that you and God will write together." The psychic left a short time later. The parents came to me and said, "What do you want to do with that? Are you going to try to counter it?" I said, "Counter it? That's preachable, folks. That's a central part of the gospel. If some scam artist, teeny psychic, can be used by God to announce to an 11-year-old girl that God will ultimately remain faithful no matter what happens, if God can use a one-time persecutor of the church who now is being persecuted and beaten and arrested, if God can use folks like that, then shouldn't we see that it is our responsibility as well? Whether it is looking at all of our buildings that are a shell of what they once were, whether we are looking at the costs of fixing this that's going to run way above what insurance will pay, whether it is families in our neighborhoods or maybe even families right here who have no insurance, whether it's folks that are going through painful moments that have nothing to do with the storm at all, moments of darkness and despair, people that are on the edge of the abyss and have heard a voice say to them, 'This is it. There's nothing more.' It is in those situations that God has called us, and we have a responsibility as people of faith to announce in both word and actions that this is not the end of the story. The magnificent word God is writing in and through our lives will not ultimately conclude with darkness or pain or suffering. God will find a way to complete it, to accomplish it, to perfect it, to bring it to a beautiful and amazing end, even when we cannot foresee what that might be." Folks, that's what I've loved about these last few weeks of coming together since the flood, a togetherness where people are not consumed by the darkness, where people are not feeling as if the future is bleak and there is no hope at all. What I love and what I believe is that what we are doing together is a practice session, if you will, for what we need to be doing out in the community, what we need to be doing in the neighborhoods and in the shelters and in the hospitals and in the schools, or wherever we might find ourselves interacting with people who have been pushed to the edge of the abyss and have heard that voice say, "This is it." We need to be there as well to announce something else, like the Apostle Paul did to the Philippians, to announce not only with our voices but our lives that the end of this story is more beautiful and amazing than any of us could ever imagine. Not that we dismiss or ignore people's pain and heartache. No, it's real. And part of what we are doing is we are coming alongside those people to make it clear that we understand their pain, but we also do not want them to become consumed in that experience. And so we, like the Apostle Paul did, announce to them that even though they may not be able to perceive it, even though they may not be able to imagine it, The God of all creation, the God that we know in Jesus Christ, does not allow the story to end in darkness. We are people of faith who follow Jesus Christ. And even though the disciples might have thought they were there when that tomb was closed up and the darkness consumed the body of the one that they had declared Savior, they thought it was done. They thought the story had ended, but it had not. The story really came to fruition in the garden when Mary saw Jesus, the resurrected Christ, before her. The story came to fruition when they saw those that were walking along the road. They saw the living Christ. And for us as people of faith, we need to celebrate that truth over and over again among us so that we go from this place and interact with people who are so hurt and broken, and we understand how that pain can block off the possibilities and promises. We need to be there to hold their hands and to say to them, the God of grace and mercy revealed in Jesus Christ remains faithful. And the work that God started in you is not a work that God's just going to say, oh, sorry, I'm out of here. No, God will remain faithful. God will not let one of us go. God will continue to work with us and through us. And the story of our lives, even though we may not imagine it, will end in such a way that is so beautiful and amazing. And I believe this day that the story of this church, it may appear to be a little bleak, but it's just one chapter. Somewhere in the middle, God has some pretty amazing chapters to write in and through all of us. And I don't know about you, I find that to be pretty good news. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Let me take all of this to God in prayer. There is a tough road ahead. Obstacles, struggles that bring a sense of hopelessness and despair. Oh, good and gracious God, your story is our story. We are never left alone, for you are there. As the psalmist suggests, your presence comforts us. Yet life can pile it on pretty thick, and darkness can easily consume us, consuming our sisters and brothers, whether they are a few blocks away, or attempting to live life amidst the rubble around Mexico City, or just trying to survive in a war-ravaged area somewhere around the globe. It is understandable how easy it is for people to be overwhelmed and lost, to feel as if the story is on its last page. Call us, invite us, show us how it is our responsibility to give voice to your redemptive work. Call us to bring tangible expressions of hope and possibility. If you can use one like Paul to bring good news, then why not us, God? Allow your spirit to infuse us today and every day so that when the story appears over, we can announce that the good work that has been done is in the hands of a gracious God, your hands, God. That story will continue to be written to that place of joy and celebration, beauty and peace. We offer these words now in the name of Christ Jesus, who drew his disciples together and draws us together in a common prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I'm going to invite God to come forward now. He's going to have a few words to share.
Thank you, Bruce. I just wanted to, my name is Clyde Hunter. My wife and I were married in 1981, later that year. a young Reverend Lynn came and asked us, invited us to this church. Also, probably before fall softball season, so they also invited me to that. We played 35 years or so. And the reason we still go to this church, we moved to Conroe about 10 years ago, is because you can't make old friends, and we have a ton of them in this church. Since the flood, I've met all four neighbors. We own a property over here off of Creekley Street, off of Cypresswood. We owned it for about a year. Didn't know any of the neighbors. Since the flood, I've met them all and become friends with them. A footnote, I like to catch catfish and fry them for my friends. One of my neighbors across the street gave me a sign that says, "A fisherman lives here with the best catch of his life." I believe God has a sense of humor. When I arrived at the house, there was a school of shad in the front yard. Fred can relate to that. He's a fisherman as well. I believe I also have a sense of humor. About three or four Sundays ago, a news reporter from the Washington Post came by the house and was interviewing me. And my wife and I were both brought up Catholic, and we got holy water on our brain. So I said, "Well, actually, this flood has been kind of a blessing." She says, "How do you figure that?" I said, "Well, the water, our church is upstream from our home. The water flowed through our house and must have brought us some holy water, so we must be blessed." Now I'm going to relate to what has been going on in our life for the last 3.5 weeks. Having helped my friend Charlie for 2 days before the water was taken to my home, I was prepared for what I found. Upon arrival, I had hope. The aerobic system was spraying in the front yard. The porch light was on. I walked into the house after having 6 foot of water, and one of the air conditioners was blowing cool air. How can you not be hopeful? I whispered, "Thank you, Jesus. Not bad for a 6 foot bloodline." All day Friday, removing rotten food and furnishings with my son and wife and daughter and Peggy Foose. Saturday, my grandson Dustin had a 6-man team, including a woman, the best worker of the whole bunch, and wet sheetrock removed before dark. My brother worked nonstop as well. Strangers brought us food every day. So much love and goodwill from God's children. There were Mormons with supplies, families with lunches, Christians from Amarillo spraying mold control, a stranger with an American Express voucher given to me in the driveway while going up the front lawn with Italian food dinner that someone else had just delivered. I had a check in one hand and the food in the other hand. Friends helped monetarily, and Coastal Plains Ministry helped us as well. I thank Robert Reed, Donnie King, and the little lady at Food Town in front of me at the register one morning. I was buying 2 bags of ice, and we started discussing the flood, and she insisted on paying for my 2 bags of ice. I thank all God's children for the loving assistance, faith in God, hard work and hope, and a sense of humor has got us through the last 3.5 weeks. I pray that the love I have witnessed does not recede with the flood waters. I submit this will pass, and one day will be a footnote. My first real hurricane was Hurricane Carla. I was in the 7th grade. We lived in Smithville, Texas. All our relatives from Houston joined us. The hurricane beard came right over Smithville. We had 98-mile-an-hour winds, and it stripped all the pecans from two bumper crop pecan trees, and it sounded like machine gun bullets in the roof. That's pretty cool for a 7th grader. The next week when I went back to school, my English teacher asked for a poem. And I usually write poetry, but I didn't write this one. We're sitting at the supper table, and I said, "Dad, my English teacher wants us to write a poem about the hurricane." And without missing a beat, he goes, "Well, the wind blew and the shingles blew, and we didn't get no sleep for a night or two." I hope at some point we can put this behind us. develop us or destroy us. It's our choice. He has a plan. And in closing, thank you very much for this opportunity, Bruce.
We picked a song today called No Longer Slaves, and one of the reasons I chose it is because we do it some in Spanish and some in English, and I thought, you know, there might be a family or a person who comes from these neighborhoods, and there might be somebody who speaks Spanish and it might mean something to them. But in this song it says, "You have chosen me, and love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. And your blood flows through my veins," which it says, I am a child of God. And I believe we are called to be his children. If I say it to you, will you say it back to me? I am
a child
of God.
Soy un
hijo
de Dios.
So I don't think he saves us to be his children for ourselves. Of course, when he saved Saul, Paul went and told other people about him and touched and blessed other people. So that's why, not only for ourselves, so we can bless others.
I
to hear your voice in the midst of all the noise. We look to you for strength and resilience to face the coming days where new beginnings and new possibilities await us. These things that we ask in your Son's name. Amen.
On the night of Jesus' betrayal, he met with the 12 disciples up in an upper room, and he took an ordinary loaf of bread, and he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, broken for you." And after the meal, he took the cup, and after he had blessed it, he gave it to them, saying, "Take, drink, this is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many. Do this every time you drink in remembrance of me." We come together at this table, this Lord's table of our home, as a family, and come together with all of our brokenness, all of our differences, and together we are here and we are one. Here at Cypress Creek, we take the bread and dip it in the cup and partake of the holy meal. The last of the back two rows will be served, and those of you who are not on the back two rows, please come forward. The meal has been prepared. Please come.
No, I'm kidding. Thank you.
one another as God is good to you. I do want to lift up that one of the programs, ministries we were just starting when the flood water showed up was a prayer initiative for foster children that are in foster care. And I know that Pat and Cindy, did they already step out? They may have. They got little packets for those that did sign up. And I still think they have some other packets. It comes with a list of 10 children that are in foster care. We don't get names. We just get male, female, and age. But the hope is, as we were one of the pilot churches in this, but to find enough churches that every child in Houston that's in foster care is being prayed for. And so, especially at this time when many of their lives have been turned on end, it is good for us to be lifting them up in prayer. I invite you to take the hand of somebody close and let us share together in our closing prayer.
Okay.
Gracious God, may your love